Welcome to Cafe DC. I'm Faiz Rahman, and our guest today is Mr. Tabbassum Mumtaz. He flew in from Texas for this show, and we appreciate his presence here. Tabbassum, welcome to Cafe DC.
Thank you, Faiz.
Without having a longer intro, I'm just going to dive in.
Sure.
And basically, you're a very successful young entrepreneur. You started very small, and mashallah, you are now a hugely successful business person. And so I won't disclose anything else and let you tell us something about you and your life story.
Out of all that introduction, I love the way you said young. So I wish I stay young all the time. But again, I think...
You are young, of course. Yeah.
Like it, man. I already like you now. I think Faiz, coming to this country, as you know, first of all, a blessed country and a very beautiful place that we are in, both of us. And also coming from another beautiful country, Pakistan, you know, is such an amazing thing that when you come here, you look at an ocean and you say, well, what do I have to do? Do I dive in or do I drain myself, you know, or drown myself? The only option was to start learning how to swim. Mm-hmm. And that's what we did. I mean, started as a cook. And
at a fast food restaurant,
right? In a fast food restaurant. Wendy's and Long John Silver's were my first restaurants that I started working at. And later on became Wendy's franchisee. Mm-hmm. And today we own the entire Long John Silver's brand, both domestic and international, 1,300 units throughout the world.
Wow.
And we also have...
So whenever you see a Long John Silver restaurant, that's you.
That's ours.
That's Tabbassum's restaurant.
Absolutely.
Okay, good.
Then
in Virginia,
also,
New York,
you name it,
Karachi, Mumbai,
Singapore,
Tokyo,
Japan,
Singapore.
You know, Malaysia,
yeah.
Absolutely. So again, I mean, you know, without that also, that's the franchisor that we are, 1,300 units on that. We also have our own 300 units, which is 200 KFCs, 50 some Taco Bells, and then also some Long John Silver's restaurants that we also own as a company as
so
well.
Privately held company owned by you.
Correct.
And you're the CEO running
Absolutely.
The day-to-day affairs of that company.
So Long John Silver is, of course, you know, it's a franchisor that we own. We are the investors in that business, and we have a proper CEO who's running that. Mm-hmm. Our own 300 units that we have, stores, restaurants, whatever you want to call it. Of course, I'm the CEO for that. Mm-hmm. We have around 7,000 employees.
Mm-hmm.
We run around $3 million
And that's across the country?
Across the country, yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. So one of the largest KFC franchisees we are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and our average bi-weekly payroll is around $3 million. You know, we do 18,000 plus man hours a day.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I mean, $250 million sales just on our franchise units that we are franchisees of. So I think, you know, when I look back, I would just say that it's just a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
It's
quite a blessing. I mean, see, having a house, your own house, and maybe a six-figure salary would constitute as an American dream for so many of us, right? But yours is like a much larger story. You started very young and very small. And then reach this height. So congratulations. But
thank you.
But see, what was your motive? What was driving you all along? Why? I mean, when you look back, you really wanted to get here where you are right now, or you were just trying to figure out stuff and things just kind of worked in this case?
Even more. Mm-hmm. I mean, I still have the same drive and passion that I had from day one. I even want to grow more. I mean, you know, the number of units.
Why?
The number of units
is not there.
What's
your idea of growth?
Okay. So, and I'm glad that you ask. I mean, you know, see, when you said about the six-digit figures and, you know, all these guys, I mean, we, regardless of how much you make, you know, that's not even my passion. See, I love making money. But my only reason of making money is so I can give more. You know, today in my own organization, I have five of my own employees who are franchisees because we want to make sure someone held my hand. We're holding other people's hand and making them franchisees and business owners. So I don't believe in ESOP. I believe in actual reality of ownership. So a lot of those folks that we are making owners and making sure that the economy turns around like that by giving employment to those folks is there. So again, what drives me? People drive me. The biggest asset in my industry is people. I mean, you know, and if you look at those folks who actually join me, and help me grow. They are the reason behind that. I mean, I still have my best friends as the ones who I started with, as cooks, as team members. And to me, staying
grounded. In much bigger role, I suppose.
Of course, yeah. I mean, we help them grow with us. And again, I mean, you know, I look back and they look back. When we look at each other, our first and only thing that we say is, let's retire together. And when you have a rhythm, a synergy together like this with your team, there is no stoppage. So again, I mean, you know, the drive is always going to be there. We, in 2008, when the recession was there, we were growing. 2009, 10, when nobody was growing, thank God we were growing. Even now, I mean, you know, when the access to capital is easy, you know, we're still growing. We just acquired another publicly traded company, Morgan's Food, converted that into private right away. Looking at another three transactions, hopefully, God willingly, if it goes well, in the first half of next year. So again, I mean, you know, the fact to grow is not to make more money. The greed is not there. Because alhamdulillah, thank God, I mean, you know, he has blessed us with everything that you can think of. But the fact that we can grow people with us, we're taking them with us, they're taking us with them. And that
grows. So are you talking about like trickle-down effect, or is it something like you make more and then it trickles down and, you know, gets to the other people? They also become basically you know.
Well, I mean, again, not necessarily that route, but I mean, again, the reality is if you look at people around you, right, and if you see that there is a need that you can do, help. I think that is the best satisfaction one can get. You can have 1,000 units. I mean, you can have whatever. I mean, you can make billions in this wonderful country, and sky's the limit. But you know, how many people actually can you help? That's what the key is. A friend of mine's asked me, like, well, when are you coming in the top 200 in the in the Forbes and all that? What is your plan for that? I say, if you ask me how am I going to help and be in the top 200 people who helped others, I can give you a plan right now, because that to me is success. And I'm not saying it because, you know, today we are doing the interview and all that stuff. I'm telling you because of the fact that this is what the belief is. We have Apex Family Foundation that we created, and it's all created by my own team. Collects around $1 million a year, you know, and helps scholarships.
By the way, what's the name of your company?
Apex okay. Brands.
How
Apex
do you spell it?
APEX.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. That's
yeah. And again, I mean, you know, the more you look at the team that we have, and the more you look at the business that we are in restaurant business, right? And restaurant business is so simple. I tell my folks that, look, it's directly connected with God. You go into a restaurant, and you get a cold, nasty piece of product, you know, or food, the first thing comes out of your heart is like, God, this is nasty, right? So you are indirectly, unintentionally telling God that, you know, this is great, this is bad.
You don't want to come back here.
Yeah, that curse is coming to the business as well. But when you get a good piece of product, you know, chicken, for example, right? I mean, you know, or fish, for example, the first thing comes out, God, this is delicious. You're putting the blessing to the food, the blessing to the business. And I think that's what the simplicity of our business is. And that's what the belief is as well, to keep God with you and make sure start your hand like this and not like this.
Very good. Tabbassum, of course, yours is a great immigrant story. And you came here, you became so successful. And that's why this country is called land of opportunity, right? But, I mean, there's also the other side. I mean, there's still a lot of poverty. There are still folks without even enough food on the table. People go hungry, children go hungry. So what you see common in the immigrant community, especially, I mean, across the board, if you see in California, there are lots of, you know, high-tech information technology folks who have become overnight billionaires, literally. They boarded, you know, they came from India, and within months or years, they were billionaires. So, yes, it's a great story. It's good to be rich. It's good to be so resourceful. It's good to be so helpful, having the opportunity to help your fellow human beings. But do you also see the contrast? And what's your take on that contrast? Why?
Well, you know, remembering your roots and basis is the key. Yes, you can be a billionaire within no time by being either in an IT business or, you know, the Googles of the world and the Yahoos of the world, and employees turn around their lives right away. But, you know, if you look back and you look at where you come from and you see the poverty that there is, if you can't do anything towards that poverty, to remove that poverty, shame on us. Mm-hmm. I tell you, I mean, you know, when you look at those slums and you look at people who do not have food, and the second meal is not guaranteed, and we sit here and waste so much food, you know, shame on us when we have that much power that we can actually give some of that. You know, we do a day of giving every year, 4 different states, 15,000 meals per state. We do that this country. So poverty is not just outside this country. Poverty is in this country as well. We sponsor schools in Nicaragua. We do law college in Pakistan, and, you know, other scholarships that we have played major roles at. But the fact that, you know, when you ask me about the reality of people who became billionaire and they are not able to support, or they are not looking back and seeing the realities of life. I remember when I was growing up, my mom used to give me bread and used to tell me to eat, to drink water so that my stomach stays full. And the second meal was not guaranteed. But I tell you, you know, in that small house, we used to live in 12 by 20, a small place called Ramsami. You know, people who know that, I mean, that's how I grew up. And when I look back and I see my mom, I say, you know what? She taught me how to stay happy within that small place. If I don't go back and I don't remember and I don't do anything for that area or for people in that country or India or Pakistan, shame on me. So I think you're right. I mean, no, people definitely need to look back. And yes, you are, you know, billionaire today. Well, what happens if, God forbid, you go back to the other side of the counter? Okay, I give you a small little quick thing of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. Mm-hmm. So there was a big line of people who were getting in line to get some food. Since you're talking about food and I'm in restaurant business, food is my favorite subject, right? So when you look at that line, you say, wow, that's a huge line. So people were trying to get that one meal per person. So a guy came in and he said, I need 2 meals. He said, why do you need 2 meals? The guy who was handing out the food asked that question. He said, I need one for me and one for that other guy who's sitting over under the tree and eating the, we call suki roti, you know, like dry bread, and drinking water. So the guy who was handing out the food, he looked at him, he said, you know what? That's the guy who was giving food to all these guys. And by the way, that was Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. So when you look at all these things, Fez, and those examples, those people, I mean, you know, our elders were role models for us. Why can't we be one? We be one, you know. So
are you running any projects in Pakistan? Anything that you'd like to mention?
You know, we have scholarships in Pakistan. We have law college.
Under your foundation,
yes.
Basically.
Okay. Yeah. Kashmir Law College, we helped that under Rabta Council, which my dad started several years ago. We have a lot of...
Where is that law college?
Muzaffarabad, Azad Kashmir. Yes. We indirectly help a lot of NGOs, but mostly they are all either UNICEF or United Nations, I mean, you know, connected. We also help big time to the World Hunger Relief Program, and that is something that, you know, we actively participate in that. Since it's food, it's directly connected to us, so we absolutely want to make sure we connect with the World Hunger Program, and that's one thing that we do.
Tabbassum, lots of folks watching us would like to know, is there any formula to great success? What you do to become so successful? Is there like just a very clear path to success, or it's just luck?
You know, H2O plus CO2, and, you know, I'm just kidding. I think, you know, in simple terminology, I would say hard work, believe, in yourself and your people. And also, I mean, you know, you have to have your mind and heart connected. Don't give up. Quite honestly, I mean, you know, there's going to be so many falls that you're going to get to see. I mean, all you see today, you know, it's not easy. You know, it comes up with all that experience, all that hard work, all that belief in your people and people mm-hmm. believing in you. And then quite honestly, be honest. You know, do not use shortcuts. I give you another example of Dave Thomas, mm-hmm. since I'm a restaurant guy, right? Dave Thomas, who was the founder of Wendy's. Wendy's do not sell round hamburgers. Everyone in the world sells round hamburgers. Wendy's sells square hamburgers. So someone asked Dave Thomas, why do you sell square hamburgers? You know his answer was? His answer was, I don't believe in cutting corners.
Wow.
So again, I mean, you know, don't cut corners. Don't look for shortcuts.
I never noticed it myself.
Yeah. I mean, you know, so I mean, think about this, right? I mean, you know, you're going to look for shortcuts. Your life is going to be in a shortcut. Mm-hmm. You know, do the right thing. It's like freeway driving, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you are going to get from destination A to B if you drive on a right lane that you are supposed to. But if you go into our countries and you see the land of opportunity in terms of driving over there, the minute that opportunity comes, you know, you sneak into that. So look into the right way to do it. So walk on a straight path. Hard work is absolutely the key. And believe in your people and yourself.
Tabbassum, there is another important part to success and somebody's journey to being a successful person, mentoring, like, you know, having good mentors. Were you lucky to have good mentors?
Absolutely, several. Mm-hmm. Starting from the house, parents. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, mom, my grandmother, such a role model. Mm-hmm. I mean, who to give at what time, mm-hmm. and how to deal with individuals. Rowing, I tell you, I mean, you know, that sports in my life, I mean, it'll change it. You know, it changed myself. Such a beautiful sports. I did rowing for several years in Pakistan. Represented Karachi Port Trust as well for several years. So that itself, I mean, you know, was a mentorship. The coaches over there, coming to United States, several friends. I mean, you know, you're one of them. I mean, you know, there's a lot of friends who continued to grow and continued to help others by being role models themselves. I think, you know, so many people. I mean, every single day, my own folks. I mean, you know, there's so many employees that I have today and team members.
Is there any regular formal mentoring program in your organization that you know
yes.
offer?
Absolutely. So a lot of the executive team that we have, they are supposed to mentor, and they do mm-hmm. at least 5 folks a year. And they do follow up with them. They do visit their families. They do go sit with them, and they look at the potential, and they follow up with them on every yearly basis. They even sit with them and do their financial statements with them, help them understand the growth, where they are today and where do they want to be. I also am a board member of IFA, International Franchise Association, the largest organization in the world in franchise association. We mentor other young franchisees mm-hmm. through that also. So lots of programs, the brand itself, anyone who needs any kind of help to mm-hmm. grow, to establish a new business, to buy into another existing business, whatever they need, we are always doing it. I think, you know, mentoring, being a role model, and being humble and grounded itself mentors people. They look at you and they say, look, I mean, you know, I want to be like them. Mm-hmm. Just like we look at others and say, look, I mean, you know, he's or she is so humble. We want to be like that as well. So I think that itself mentors a lot of people by how you present yourself. So the program itself, like IFA, is a big program that we do. Our own, we do 2x2s. 2x2s is like sitting one-on-one with folks and look at their graph of success and where they are today and where do they want to be. And then those executives that we have in our team, they help those guys mentor.
You also interact with the other organizations. I know you've been a speaker at several other, not just Pakistani diaspora organizations, but other professional organizations. What's your experience with them? I mean, and why do they invite you? As of course you're a successful businessman, but is it again part of like learning from each other, and how you help these other professional organizations through your interaction with them?
Yeah, I think I do speak a lot in different conferences and conventions. Restaurant Finance is one. Franchise Times, I mean, on the magazines, we do write articles on a regular basis. QSR, MUFSO, a multi-unit franchise organization. I think when we share best practices with each other, it becomes a lot easier to learn from other people's experiences. And that's one of the things that we learn when we go into others as well. And when we speak, of course, we are speaking on our own experiences, what we have gone through, what problems and challenges comes in during acquisitions or during growth or, I mean, you know, developing team, developing bench, and all that stuff. So people like to hear that. People like to hear people who have been involved in different experiences and parts of life. So we ourselves go in and learn a lot.
What's next for you?
More growth. More growth.
In terms of what? Again, more restaurants and, or maybe diversify your investments and your ownership, go into some other field. I know you love food.
Oh, yeah. Fast, I mean, I am
some clothing stores.
I'm in a lot of other businesses as well. I mean, you know, I'm also the majority owner of the second largest headsets manufacturer company, which is Wentworth Technology. And plus, I mean, you know, again, once you are in these investments, I mean, those investments just grow simply a lot. Next, like I said, I mean, growth, wherever the opportunity is, where I can grow my people. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at new brands. I'm looking at developing a brand ourselves. Mm-hmm.
How much influence do you have as a major franchise owner on the policy and products of these stores?
Excellent question. Mm-hmm. We actually do test newer products. We make sure that, you know, we are always on top in terms of operations. We are number one in the country in terms of our operations and all that. Our team actually develop newer taste and flavors. So we hire people who actually come in and mix and matches. Spices is our favorite. That's my origin. I mean, you know. So in KFC, we started spicy grilled chicken. And that's similar and close to the chicken tikka masala.
Really?
You know, so none.
So that's your contribution to
absolutely,
the.
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. So, I mean, you know, those kind of things that comes on. Mm-hmm. And in Long John Silver's, we did the hush puppies and we flavored that with jalapenos and other stuff that people love it. So the more the demographic is changing in this country, the more we are playing the role being innovatives in terms of bringing those innovative ideas to those brands. And brands look at your operational background, brand look at the size, brands look at your experiences and all that, and they absolutely respect it. So Yum has been a great partner for us, Yum Brands, and they actually have given us a lot of experiences through that as well. Both, I mean, learning from us, mm-hmm. and us learning from them also.
There are always another side to your success, you know, life and work issues, as we call. So when we become more successful, busier with our day-to-day activities and lives, you know, families suffer. What's in your case? I mean, is it how do you balance your time with the families?
Absolutely, I do spend time with my kids. Mm-hmm. My daughter Soha, I make sure that if she needs any help in terms of homework or anything, we'll make sure we'll sit down together when we do it. She's a senior now. We run together. She loves running. So me and her will go run, 5 miles or, whatever I do. It's funny, when she was two, she used to do two full 400 meters track when she was 2 years old with me. Of course, she would go baby steps and all that.
Wow.
So I would always look back and I would say, Soha, hurry up. Come on, you're slowing me down and all that. Now she looks back and she says, Papa, you're slow. Hurry up. My son, I coach
changing
his.
Changing times. Yeah.
Oh, yes. My son, he's Samir. Mm-hmm. I coach his basketball team. Okay. And, I sit with him on his homeworks as well pretty much every night. Now they both are big enough to drive and all that, so it's hard to find some time. But again, I mean, it's important to be with these kids whenever you can.
Thank you very much, Tabbassum. On this note, we'll end this program. And thank you very much for flying into Washington, D.C. from Dallas, especially for this show. Appreciate your presence. Wish you all the best. And more luck.
Absolutely, thanks for having me.
Thanks for watching another episode of Cafe DC. I'm Faiz Rahman. Please don't forget to visit our website, urduvoa.com.